People, gather now. Take this time to step out of the obstacle course of daily life and step into the loving grace of God. Here we can stop stressing and cease the judgment of having to manage it all. Here we can catch our breath and regain our balance. Here we find treasure and no wealth or striving can buy, Here the Spirit offers us kindness and care. Here we are home in the loving family of God. Scripture reading this morning is from Genesis 29:15-28. Then God said to Jacob, because you are my kinsman, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me, what should your wages be?
Thank you. So here we have the story of the trickster continuing, right? Some of you will remember that the story of Jacob began several weeks ago when Rachel was, Rebecca was pregnant carrying Jacob and Esau, and they were rolling around inside of her like they were already fighting. And no doubt they were. And when they were born, Esau came out first, the firstborn, and Jacob was holding his heel, never letting him get too far away. And as they grew up, they grew in different directions. Esau was the hunter. He liked being outdoors, and Jacob was quite the cook. And Jacob was cooking some very tasty lentil stew when Esau came home from a hunt, and Esau was really hungry, and he said, "Give me some stew." And Jacob, being who Jacob is, said, "Sure, give me your birthright and you can have some stew. That seems like an even trade." Esau was very hungry. He said, "Sure, go ahead. You have a birthright? Give me that stew." And this relationship continued in that way. Jacob went on to trick his father Isaac into giving him the blessing that goes with the birthright, lying to him, and saying, "Yes, indeed, I am Esau, giving you that blessing." And finally, Esau was really angry with Jacob and threatened to kill him. So, of course, off he runs away to the land of his ancestors' people. And he has actually, when we hear the story today, he and Laban is his uncle. Laban is his mother's brother. He's already met Rachel and fell in love with her, because this is a good story. And when Laban said to him, "Well, you know, you're not my property, and you are family, and you're working for me, and I need to pay you something, what will it be?" And they negotiated, because that's what men did then. They negotiated how the women would be used. Not that I initiated that. And as it turns out, you'll notice in the text that the language that Laban speaks, says to Jacob, doesn't actually say "sure." It says, let's see if I can find it here. Laban says, when Jacob says, I will serve you for 7 years for your younger daughter, Rachel. So he knows what he's doing here. Younger daughter, Rachel. Laban says, "It is better that I give her to you than that I should give her to any other man. Stay with me." Interesting. They could both be attorneys. And those of you who grapple with the law know, right? Look at where it connects. So Jacob actually was honorable in working the 7 years. There has been somewhat of a change. Not completely, but somewhat of a change. And then he goes to Laban and says, "Okay, give me your daughter, I want to marry her." And there's a 7-day feast, as there always is, and Laban has set it up, and at nighttime, he brings Leah, the older, to Jacob, who's probably not quite sober, and it's dark, and she is veiled. And so the marriage is consummated, and in the morning, Jacob is pretty annoyed and goes to Laban and says, Laban says, "We don't do that in this country. The elder is married first. Work for me is another 7 years. Complete the 7 days with Leah, and we will give you Rachel if you work 7 years for us." It's likely that at the end of the 7 days, Rachel was given to Jacob alone, and both of those women came with what's referred to in the text as servants. We know them to be slaves. So there's a whole lot going on here, right? And it's real easy for me to kind of throw stones at these practices, but there's something that we need to be aware of. When this text was written, and it was written about a time that was hundreds of years earlier, there were already rules on the books that said you cannot take your rice sister. So the people who are hearing this text know that this is not okay. And to some extent, they're caught up in how strange it is. So we know those things are not okay now, right? But what I want us to do is to take a minute or so now, each of us, and looking at this day, 2017, the summer in Chicago, in the United States, on this earth. And I want us to just think about those ways in which we still treat people poorly based on gender. We may be in the 21st century, but we ain't there yet. So I'm going to be quiet and let you think about that. You, those of you who have been worshiping here for the past few months are aware that one of our members, David Krauter, Gabe's dad, was applying for a position at Concordia University and in fact was resoundingly accepted and unanimously approved by everyone up the line. And he got to the head of the university, and the head of the university looked at the website of the church that David belongs to, Pilgrim Church, and Pilgrim Church commits several sins. We have a female senior pastor, we have a female moderator, and we fly the LGBTQ flag. David was told that's why he was refused the job. I know for myself that I feel like I am in a bubble, and I am grateful for the bubble I am in here at Pilgrim. And I was, when David and I sat down to talk about this experience, it wasn't like I was surprised, and yet there was some way in which I felt like I'd been punched. I am a female, and one of our members didn't get a job that he was highly qualified. Highly qualified. They've been looking for someone for this position for 2 years, and they found him. And they wouldn't accept him. They actually told him that perhaps if he would have changed church affiliations, they would be able to. I'm somewhat surprised at how this has not exactly burst the bubble, but it's shaken the bubble for me. And I'm just so grateful to the Ministry of Christian Outreach and Sue Sporty as the chair of the ministry and the Pilgrim Church for being willing to take a stand about this. Not to get Concordia to hire David, but to make a statement, to claim ourselves to be Christian, to welcome all, and to simply communicate. That's how we hold it. That is such an important, empowering step. It doesn't change anything, but it allows us to stand up and say, huh, we see ourselves as Christian too. And we're pretty outraged at what we've chosen to do. And sin, that there might be dialogue. So somewhere along the line, things might be different. And I am reminded about this morning's text. Remember the story that's told about our beginnings is a story that actually doesn't reflect what was currently going on. It had been going on, but it wasn't currently going on. And so the people were hearing this and going, wait, he can't do that. He can't marry the sister. And that says, things do change. Sometimes it takes an awfully long time to get them to change, but they will never change unless we do what MCO and Pilgrim Church has done and said, wait, this is not okay. And that speaks so much to who I believe we are, and I believe you believe we are, that we are aware of what goes on in the world, and we are willing to step out there and say, wait, this is not okay. Think about this differently. Here's how we see it. I think it's really important that we're able and willing to find the energy to keep moving forward. I can remember many years ago, before I was in parish ministry, I was a consultant, and a lot of the work I did was teaching. And I would teach, if there was a conference, I was likely to be there talking about leadership development or organizational development or marketing or any kind of thing. And I was doing this training in one of the northwestern suburbs, and the room was full, and people were engaged, and it seemed to be going well, except for this one guy. He was sitting right about there, and he just seemed to be totally distracted. So this is like maybe 30 years ago, and I'm thinking, oh yeah, here's one of these guys who don't think that women have anything to say that's useful, right? I'm confident attitude. Now I know, give it a show. It was time for a break, everyone took a break, went out, had coffee, came back, and the guy, that guy, came up to me and he said, Sally, I'm so sorry, I was really distracted. My hearing aids are not working this morning. I had to go back to my room and get new batteries. Oh, I'm so glad to hear that. Well, I hope the rest was well. The point is that sometimes we collude, right? Sometimes we get in our own way. And I'm not saying that people are making it easy for a lot of us. But we need to be cognizant of how we might be contributing. If Pilgrim was quiet about what happened to David Crowder, we would be polluted. We're not polluted. We're taking a stand. Our story helps us see the complexity of this. If, I know that a lot of us are carrying around these thoughts that, I'm just not up for this. Oh boy, if people knew what I have done, they would never be talking to me. Oh, I just don't think I'm worthy of this. Look at Jacob. My God, look at Jacob. You can't trust the guy as far as you can throw him. Oh, and yes, you remember last week when we had the Stairway to Heaven? Oh, I'm supposed to be putting these up here. I'm so sorry, Greg. No. Today's beautiful installation. Last week we had the Stairway to Heaven, and God blesses Jacob, not because of any promises Jacob made, not because of anything Jacob had done. In fact, Jacob had done nothing but be deceitful. And yet, God blesses him and promises to be with him. And what does Jacob say? If you read the rest of the text, and I don't think it was in our reading last week, Jacob says, okay, God, well, since you said you'll take care of me and you'll bring me back, if you do that, okay, then you can be my God. Oh, my, and now we get into the story. sometimes that's me. Sometimes I just don't see how I'm stuck. Jacob has been blessed by God. If Jacob can be blessed by God,
oh boy, you better believe each one of us is blessed by God.
Each one of us. These stories can be such a good when we talk about them and make them real. Jacob said, "So give me Rachel." And Laban says, "It would be better if I did that." And then gives him Leah. And for another 7 years worked, he gives him Rachel. That's how it was. We are in the 21st century. We can't stay stuck and see people as less because they're female or they're different or they're poor or they're rich. Chaos abounds. We need to see each other for who we are. We need to see each other as blessed by God. I don't get to determine who God has blessed and neither do you. And God has blessed us all. Amen.